but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? All right, so that's another scripture that will support the premise that God is not a tight-fisted God that's trying to take something away from you or trying to prevent or hinder you from receiving his rich blessings. Scripture says God is rich to all of them that call upon him. He's rich unto all of them that call upon him. And I like in that verse, he says, how shall he not with him? In other words, all of these blessings that God has provided us has come and been made possible and available and accessible through Jesus Christ. He's the one that has made all of these blessings and provisions available. It was because of Jesus. Even under the old covenant, amen, Jesus was the reason why God could release all of these mercies upon Israel and all of those that trusted him and turned to him. It was because of Jesus, the promised sacrifice, the lamb that was what? Slain. It was the blessings that Jesus would bring as a result of his death. But they were able to draw from these blessings under the old covenant even before the sufferings and the redemption was consummated. Amen. Praise God. How many know that if you're working on a job and you got $500 coming, sometimes you can just draw money from that, what? That promise of the $500 that's supposed to be what released to you at some point. Amen. A promissory note, that's what I want to say. So the blessings was due to a promissory note, the promise that Jesus would come and settle the issues and make it possible and make it legal for all of these blessings that God released into people's lives to make all of that legal. Amen. God can't do anything unless he has a reason for doing it. Amen. He just can't pour out blessings upon anybody that wants it under any condition. In fact, God can't even, he can't even intervene in this earth unless he has your permission. He has to have your permission. Amen. And how do you get God's permission? Amen. You get God's permission, amen, by prayer. Amen. God, you ever heard the statement that God can't do nothing unless you ask him? Or you pray? Amen. Because this whole universe is under the control of who? Satan. Amen. Jesus cannot just overrule or override the fact that Satan is the god of this world and release a blessing unto you unless you what? Pray in his name. Amen. You gotta what? Do it in his name. Amen. Praise God. So every blessing that we receive is in the name of Jesus. Is that right? That's the reason why we say this is the year 2011 AD, in the year of what? Our Lord and what? Savior Jesus Christ. If you sign a document, you got to what? Sign it. Amen. This is the day is what? December the what? 18, 2011 AD. That's in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Well, I told you, God has given him a name. And that name is above what? Every name. At the name of Jesus, every knee has to what? Bow, and every tongue has to what? Confess that Jesus is what? Lord. Amen. So everything that's done legally in this universe has to be in the name of what? Jesus. All right, in order for God to honor it. All right. I found a scripture that I know that you were waiting for. Amen. 2 Corinthians 8:9. I just need you to turn there just for a moment. 2 Corinthians 8:9. Well, today I'm just showing you that there are some specific things that we need to be aware of because in order for us to plug in and get all that God has for us and to take advantage of all of these bountiful blessings that God has for us, there is certain things that we got to do. There are certain things that we must know. Amen. In order for these mercies to be released, anybody that ought to be the head, amen, that anybody that ought to be blessed and to be the head and not the tail, it ought to be a what person that's aware of what God has done for us through Christ. Amen. That's the person that should be what? On top of every problem, situation, condition, and everything that's, amen, that's focused against them. All right, this scripture says here, for we know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich. For ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich. Okay, that shows that Jesus, the scripture says in Philippians 2, it says this, that it says, let this mind, this is Philippians 2, 5, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God. Okay, now this shows that Jesus became poor. In other words, he emptied himself, all of those glorious attributes, all of his riches and wealth, all of his power and authority, he relinquished that, and he came down in the form of a servant. Very poor. And how many know that Jesus was rich when he existed, amen, from eternity with his Father? Amen. He was rich. And all of those glorious attributes which describe our God were the attributes which describe the Son of God from eternity. Now, he was very, very rich, very wealthy. He had full dominion and power. All things were under his feet. Amen. He was co-equal with power, amen, to God. Amen. So he became poor. He gave it all up. He relinquished it and took it all, laid it aside, left heaven, and came down in the form of a what? Of a servant. He became a natural man. This is the way that you can explain that Jesus became poor for our sakes. Amen. So that he could, so that we through his poverty might be made what? Rich. So when Jesus finished his redemptive work and went back to heaven to sit down at the right hand of his Father, amen, he was operating in the position of our faithful high priest. Amen. Our faithful and compassionate high priest. He sits now at the right hand of our Father. Amen. Jesus is there interceding. He's there praying for you. He's there making sure that every provision, every promise that was ever offered you would actually become reality. Yes. That's his present day ministry. Our high priest, our advocate, our Lord, our Savior, the surety of our covenant. He's all of that right now. So the scripture says this very plainly, that he has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. So when Jesus finished his work, that means every spiritual blessing, amen, that God provided, has provided, amen, had become yours in, amen, in reality. Legally is yours, and it's yours when you appropriate those promises. It's yours in reality. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Now, somebody ought to be a little bit excited. Amen. He's blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places through Christ Jesus. He didn't hold back nothing. God didn't hold back nothing. He didn't even hold back his own son, but delivered him up for us all. Amen. This is what he said. How shall then those with him, amen, and Christ doing all of that, relinquishing all that he had, came down in the form of a servant, came obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him, given him a name above what? Every name. Amen. Hallelujah. So Jesus is there at the right hand of the Father, acting as our mediator. And whenever we pray in the name of Jesus, amen, that prayer is honored every time. Amen. Whatever you ask in my name, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he says what? I'll do it. Whatever you ask the Father in my name, amen, praise God, he'll do it. Whatever you demand in my name, I'll do it.
Amen.
Amen. Every spiritual blessing. Right? Somebody says every spiritual blessing. If you're kind of puny spiritually, don't have no joy, don't have no peace, and can't get it right, amen, praise God, can't live, don't have strength to live for God, amen, that provision is already yours. Amen. So you got to learn how to tap in on it. That's what I'm going to teach you today, if you listen to me. Hey, hallelujah. And there's another scripture which says that God has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. This is 2 Peter. He has blessed us with every thing that pertains unto life and godliness. So that means the natural and the spiritual has already provided. In other words, amen, when man started out initially in the Garden of Eden, what belonged to him was astounding. That means the entire works of God's hands, amen, when God placed man in that garden, everything belonged to that man. Amen. I mean, we started out rich. Why do we have to end up poor? Amen. Started out rich in the garden. Is that right? It started out rich. Amen. So Jesus, amen, the devil messed it up because of what? He took everything away. When man sinned, then what? All of those blessings that were legally man, all of those were turned over to what? Satan. Is that right? But Jesus came, what, to restore back to us everything that the devil stole. Woo! Hallelujah! And the way he did it, it was through what? Him emptying himself, relinquishing all of those rights and privileges that he enjoyed as what? God. Came down in the likeness of what? Sinful flesh. Amen, right? Hallelujah! Became a man. What? That's some condescending. That's some humiliation. Amen. More, I would rather be God any day. Amen. Praise God. Just to be a little old peon like me. Amen. But one good thing about this little peon, God is in me. Woo! And that's a big deal because when Jesus, amen, praise God, finished his work and then he ascended to the Father, amen, became our intercessor, became our high priest, became our mediator, became a surety of everything that he has promised. Amen. That meant that, praise God, that I could what, draw, amen, from those promises and provisions just by what? Whispering the name of Jesus in my prayer. Because Jesus is what? On the inside of me. See, the Holy Ghost is in me. But the Holy Ghost and Jesus, who's at the right hand of the Father, and God the Father, all one, it's the same thing.
Yes,
amen. Co-equal in power. How many can say amen?
Amen?
So if the Holy Ghost is in me, God is what? He's in me.
He's back.
Woo! Glory. Amen. And you know, amen, you know if God is on the inside of me, the Holy Ghost is on the inside of me.
Yes.
And when I pray, pray in the name of Jesus, you know I'm going to get some what? Some response. Hey, hallelujah. So it's not a problem getting your prayer through. Amen. That's no problem. The Bible says this is the confidence that we have in Him. If we ask anything, if we ask anything, if we ask what? Anything. Amen. Praise God. He hears us. If we ask anything in His name, He hears us. How many believe that God hears you when you pray? Jesus said this, God always hears me. He said, Lord, I thank you that you've already answered it. Even before he prayed it. That's confidence, ain't it? Lord, that was a big deal because Lazarus had been stinking 4 days. And Jesus was at the grave site, amen, and he was about to raise a man back from the dead. He said, Lord, I thank you for what you're about to do, because you've already what? You've already handled this. I mean, this thing is already what? In the job. It's already happened. As far as I'm concerned. Amen. So, I believe that's the confidence that we have in Him. If we ask anything according to His will, He heareth us. And if we know that He heareth us, then we know that He hath a what? Petition of the thing that we have asked Him for. How many believe that we can decree a thing, and the thing that we decree shall be established? Yes. Amen. So I like that, praise God, because this lets us know that the price for our redemption and all that we need, all of these mercies that we need, that we see, amen, all of these things have already been what? Freely given. Freely. Touch somebody and say, freely. 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 Amen. So Jesus is there. You ain't got to pull his teeth. You ain't got to go through a whole lot of changes. He wants to do it. The Bible says he has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants. Pleasure. He gets pleasure when you show up at the throne. Amen. Putting a demand on him. Amen. For any need that you have. He gets pleasure. Amen. Praise God. Some of y'all look back and say, I don't believe it. That's easy. Yes, it is. Whatever you ask in his name, he says what? He'll do it. Amen. If you know that he heareth us, then we know that we have the petitions of the thing. Amen. Praise God. We know that he heareth us because we what? We keep his commandment. Amen. Somebody says, I know some kind of catch to it. We keep his commandment. We keep his commandment and do those things that are what? Pleasing. In his sight. How many can say amen? All right, so we can see that these mercies that God has provided us, they are freely given, freely provided us, but the only thing that we have to keep in mind, amen, that you have to place yourself in a position, amen, for those mercies to be released into your life. You have to place yourself in a position where these what? Mercies. Amen. Can be what? Released. God just can't do anything arbitrarily without you what? Cooperating with Him. Because I'm telling you that Satan is still the God of this world. Right? And he has legal authority over everything that goes on in this nation, in this world. And the only way you can what? Supersede that authority, you have to be in Christ. Ooh. Woo! You gotta be in Christ. That's the reason the scripture says if any man be in Christ, he becomes a what? New creature. Yes. And then the Bible says, he said, then once you begin to get in Christ and begin to what? Begin to walk in Christ and to walk in righteousness, then the thing is this, amen, that you supersede even the laws of life of death. Scripture says, if, amen, have this done, if the spirit of him that raised Jesus from the dead, that's one scripture. He said, for the spirit of the law of life in Christ Jesus has made me what? Free from what? The law of what? See, this is the thing that releases us from Satan's law.
Alright.
Satan's dominion. Satan, woo, woo. Satan's authority. That frees you. Y'all don't believe that, do you? Jesus said, Satan came to me, and he confessed. find nothing in me to respond to. Hey, hallelujah. So I'd rather be in Christ. But I'm telling you, being in a world like we are dealing, I mean, like all of this negative and adversity and trials and hardships and heartaches and pains and all of that, being in this world alone without Christ, not being in Him, not being able to get a prayer through, I don't think anybody wants to be in that position. Amen. So if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things what? Pass away. Behold, all things are new. So that's your safety net. Being what? In Christ. God is my refuge and my strength. Praise of Him. And I like this. The Bible says it's God's good pleasure to give me the kingdom. Yeah, Jesus. Amen. It's God's good what? Pleasure. It's a pleasure for God to, for you to appear before the throne and place a demand on your Heavenly Father. It's a pleasure. Now some of y'all approach the throne just like a whipped puppy dog. With his leg with his tail between his legs. God is just waiting for you to appear. He said he sees your face with pleasure. It's God's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Why not make the sacrifice, whatever you have to do, whatever position, amen, you have to be in for God to release these blessings. Amen. Why not make the sacrifice or make the commitment? Bible says the way of the transgressor is what? Hard. Ooh, I like that. The way of the transgressor is hard. But Jesus said, my yoke is easy. And my burden is light. Hey, yeah, yeah, yeah. You might not be able to go to the gambling club and enjoy all of those tempting. I mean, it looks so glamorous around. I mean, it's like Hollywood. but it would be worth it. Amen. Amen. To what? To forego the pleasure. The Bible says the pleasures of sin just for what? Season. Amen. It just does enough just for what? Keep you out of position for these mercies to be released into your life. Now, if it's going to block me, because anything, praise God, that, you know, I know gambling places, you know, I'm not trying to mess up nobody's picnic. But I know some things are kind of like addictive. How many know some things can be addictive? Amen. Someone said if you give the devil an inch, you'll take a mile. So the best thing, don't let the devil what? Wrath. Resist evil. Amen. Praise God. Don't let the devil wrath. If you give him an inch, he's going to take what? 20 miles. Amen. Because if you let him ride, don't pick him up now. Don't pick him up. Amen. Get over, Brother Wendell. Get over. He said, if you pick him up, he's going to say, get over, let me drive. If you let him ride, he's going to want to what? He's going to want to drive. And I tell you, boy, we could be receiving so many blessings and benefits if we refused to let a whole lot of this carnal junk. Amen. Now, y'all tell me, how much money have you won in the last 10 years going to the... Y'all tell me. Between me and you and the gatepost. well, here's the thing. Yeah, I mean, they're getting rich for sure. They're getting rich off your money. Yeah, I imagine everybody probably make a little, you know, win every once in a while. They let you win so often. to keep you encouraged. All right. Right, she won a truck. All right, she won a truck and probably paid for three. Okay, well, we don't talk about that. We don't get off of, we'll move on further. But this is what the Lord spoke to me about how that we can tap in to these lessons. And I want you to turn to some scriptures that God gave me. I believe this is going to really minister to you tremendously. I want you to turn to 1 Kings 17. 1 Kings 17. 1 Kings 17. That's going to be the first passage. 1 Kings 17. Because we have already talked about Job, but you know, we can talk about it a little bit later. 1 Kings 17, verses 9 through 16. Okay. This is the story of a lady that was a widow, and she was at the verge of starvation. And it was a famine in the land. And it was Elijah. Okay, let's look at verse 9. And the word of the Lord, verse 8, came unto him, saying, Arise, get thee to Zarephath, which belongeth to Zidon, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain thee. So he arose and went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate of the city, behold, the widow woman was there gathering of sticks. And he called to her and said, Fetch me, I pray thee, a little water in a vessel that I may drink. As she was going to fetch it, he called to her and said, Bring me, I pray thee, a morsel of bread in thy hand. And she said, As the Lord thy God liveth, I have not a cake, but a handful of meal in a barrel, and a little oil in a cruse. And behold, I'm gathering two sticks that I may go in and dress it for me and my son that we may eat it and die. So that was her last batch of meal and her last cruse of oil. They were going to make that their last meal just before they would eat that and die, because a famine was in the land, no food to be found. Okay, so they were going to eat that and die. And Elijah said unto her, Fear not, go and do as thou hast said, but make me thereof a little cake first, and bring it unto me, and after make for thee and for my son. That was a bold demand. I mean, that's all she had. She was getting ready to cook that handful of meal, and that was going to be it. And then here comes this prophet and said, Don't be afraid. Go and make the cake, bake it. Here's what I want you to do. He says, Bring it unto me and make for thee and for thy son. He says, I want you to go and do as thou hast said, but make me thereof a little cake first. Make me the first cake. That was all she had left. Now, how did she know for sure that if she made that first cake for him, it would be more for her? For her and her son. She didn't what? She know. She didn't know. Alright. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel. This is a man that showed up out of nowhere. How did she know that this was a man of God? The barrel of meal shall not waste. Here's what the Lord said. The barrel of meal shall not waste, neither shall the cruse of oil fail, until the day that the Lord sendeth rain upon the earth. And she went in and did according to the saying of Elijah, and she and he and her house did eat many days. And the barrel of meal wasted not, neither did the cruse of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord, which he spake by Elijah. Now, what can you say about this woman that out of the clear blue sky responded to the prophet, obeyed, submitted to the prophet also, because that she submitted to God. Amen. Somehow, she heard the voice of the Lord speak to her heart. She placed herself in a position where God's blessings and God's mercies could reach her. Suppose she would have said, "This is all I got. I don't care how much you beg, plead. I don't care who you say you are, man of God, and I don't care what God's saying even." Now suppose she had taken that position. What would have happened to her? She would have perished. But she placed herself in a position where the grace of God, the blessings of God, or the mercies of God could reach her. And that is the reason, the first point I want to make is many do not experience these mercies released into their life because of the failure to submit to God. See, sometimes God's voice is reflected or projected through, not just, God doesn't speak to everybody from heaven. Amen. Sometimes people take this position. If God spoke to me personally, if God came down here, and I knew it was God, I would do anything he would say. Jesus came down here, talked to me, and I knew for sure it was Jesus, I would do anything he said. If the Holy Ghost walked into this room today, if I knew it was the Holy Ghost, and he talked to me, I would do whatever the Holy Ghost said. But I ain't going to do what nothing no man say. I ain't going to submit to no man. And a whole lot of people in the church, amen, they obey God. I mean, I don't care what I preach. I don't care what I teach. I don't care what I say. Some people are going to what? Do what they want to do. They're not going to what? Hear God, nor man, or nobody else. Especially if it relates to their money. And I got a nice little scripture for you too. God is not a withholder. God freely give us all things to enjoy. God, somebody said, God is rich in houses and land. He holds the wealth of the world in his hand. Silver and gold, rubies and diamonds. What's the other part? There was a problem on my window. Something about the blessings untold. Amen. His riches untold. Okay, but here's the thing. Here's a scripture the Lord quickened to me yesterday, today. It says, withhold not good from them to whom it is due, when it's in the power of your hand to do it. See, God is not a withholder, and then you're trying to what? Trying to what? Withhold. Y'all are on the same page. But yet you want what? Faith, your faith, your blessing, what? To be released. That won't work. I mean, y'all ain't getting that. I better try to find that scripture. All right, that's Proverbs 3:27. I want you to turn there. Then I got another fat scripture after that. It's going to be Proverbs 11:24. Proverbs 11:24. That one is better than the first one. Proverbs 11:24. Okay, let's do the 3:20. What did I say first? Proverbs 3 what? Okay, let's read that together. Saints, y'all here? Amen. How many saints we got? Y'all scared to say you're saints. You don't want to be a name. You want to be a saint. Okay, let's read that very loud and clear. All right. Withhold not what? Good from them to whom it is due, when it is in the power of your hand To do it. Now, this is committing, okay, let's do the other one before we go further. Proverbs 11:24. Now, this is coming under a category, when I said submitting to God, this is coming under a category that probably is the cardinal neglect of most believers that short-circuit their faith and cause them to suffer, go through changes, and never experience God's best. Because many times we're in the withholding business, especially in the area of our money, sometimes in the area of our time, sometimes in the area of our talent. If you're holding out on God in any of those three areas, amen, you're going to experience much difficulty because God is a God of mercy. Is that right? God is a God of mercy. Is that right? He's full of what? Mercy, full of compassion. Hallelujah. And if we are not in union, if we don't have the scripture says, if we don't have the spirit, if any man has not the spirit of Christ, he's not of his. Okay, let's go back to 11:24. Okay, somebody read that for me. Mm-hmm.
There is that scattering.
Mm-hmm.
And he increases.
Mm-hmm.
There is that withholdeth more than his meat, but it tendeth to poverty.
Okay, let's read that again because that's a scripture. It's withholding. That's a withholding scripture. Okay, let's read it again. Saints, I didn't hear nobody but Sister Hill. Okay, one man gives freely, yet grows all the richer. One man gives freely, and yet grows all the richer. Another withholds what he should give, and only suffers poverty or want. Okay, hold back no benefit from those entitled to it. Do not keep back good from those who have a right to it, when it is in the power of your hand to do it. Okay, so that shows that this is a cardinal blunder that many times make, because many times we withhold too much. In other words, we hold back too much. You know, sometimes we just kind of inch it out when it comes to the church, you know, some don't even tithe. It would be interesting just to see who gives the pastor an offering. Sometimes I get these offerings. I say, how many gave? Two or three? Oh, praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. Y'all ain't with me. But here's a statement I want to make. Faith is the union of our hearts and wills with God's will and God's purpose. And where this unity is lacking, results are impossible. Now, this is the reason why many times people are not getting the results that they need. They hold back too much, amen, from God and to those who are entitled to receive. And the scripture says that don't do that. Don't withhold. It says what? Withhold not good from them to whom it is due. Now, I think that people that minister to you, I think that something is due them. People want to draw, want you to pray your lungs out. Howl and squall, want to grow them. And amen, they want their breakthroughs. And many times, they don't want to what? Respond even with a dollar. It will be very interesting. And I don't look at books much. I don't look at books. Sister Hill keeps up with things better than I do. I don't like to do that because sometimes it gives you what? Sometimes you, I thought they were for me. I thought they were supporting me. People look at us and say, well, they don't look like they need nothing. You believe people look at us sometime? I ain't gonna give that pledge. I ain't gonna give my anniversary money. They got more than I got. Well, you ought to understand, praise God, until 2 years ago, we didn't have what we have now. And it was a fate of God. I mean, it was just a miracle how God overruled things and blessed us regardless of, the devil didn't want to see us blessed. Just like my brother in Arkansas, he told me this. He says that people have always told me, he's a mission man, and he's probably given everything almost that he has ever earned, almost it seemed like, and maybe not, to missions. I mean, he supported a whole lot of missions all over. And he said people have told him for years that that you will never have anything because all that you get, you just always give it into missions. You'll never have anything. Well, last year, Sister Dorothy, his house burned. Amen. He said, well, the devil meant it for evil. Yeah. But God turned it around and made it work for my good. God has a way of blessing people. You can't be God what? Well, I tell you, I wouldn't trade places with nobody now. I know that many months I probably give, I have to sometimes pick up things that I shouldn't be picking up.